tell you that this is a session I think that will be particularly interesting. It's very relevant to the times we live in and very relevant to the kind of stories that are being broken or not being broken these days. And we have three veteran journalists on the panel with us to talk about the perils of business reporting. You all know Paranjoy, Guha, Thakurta, Maheshwar, Peri, and Josy, Joseph. They've written books, have done exhaustive investigative stories. All of them have paid a price for that through numerous litigation that has been thrust upon them by big business houses and industrialists. And actually, you know, the title of this session being The Perils of Business Reporting, given the times we live in, I was wondering whether we should just call it The Perils of Reporting, period, because there is so much we see that is, you know, not being reported today, and for obvious reasons. But I want to begin with initial comments from the panelists here today. And Paranjoy, to start with you, we are here gathered on a day when this morning the Indian Express had a story about how another case against the Adani Group, you know, has been dropped by the authorities. You have The Wire, which is facing a huge defamation and a criminal defamation case at that, from Jay Shah, the son of Amit Shah. So in a sense, this is all deja vu for you. I don't even think you were surprised that he slapped them with a 100 crore defamation notice.
Nidhi, thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak here. There's a technical word for it. Slap. S-L-A-P-P. Strategic litigation against public participation. It's a word that's used across the world. It means that here is somebody who's powerful, and that person uses the law, truths, which are considered unpleasant truths, and therefore you send a message to everybody. It's called the chilling effect. You tell everybody else, don't mess around with me. I can take you to court. The long arm of the law can be very, very long. The wheels of justice can grind very, very slowly, excruciatingly slowly. Everybody has the right to sue. Of course, everybody has the right to sue. And of course, you have the right to defend yourself. Truth is supposed to be the defense, the most important defense. What if what you've written is truthful without malice? Then that's your ultimate defense. My experience has shown at least a few of the richest individuals in India. Some of them have served legal notices and stopped there. I refer to Mr. Mukesh Dhirubhai Ambani, lawyers representing his companies. I refer to his younger brother, Anil Ambani. I refer to Mr. Subroto Roy Sahara. I refer to Mr. Gautam Adani. I'm honored and privileged. I've received legal notices from their lawyers. As we talk, day after tomorrow, at a court in Bhuj, a judge is scheduled to hear whether an article co-authored by me has lowered his esteem in the eyes of the people of India. I believe that my facts are correct. Time will tell. So the short point is that while everybody has the right to sue another person, I think we also have the right to defend. But the legal process is so time-consuming, the legal process is so expensive. In different parts of the world, including the United Kingdom, once upon a time, London used to be known as the defamation capital of the world. But even there, the laws have changed. I think it's about time that we in this country seriously look at decriminalizing defamation. Let it be a civil offense. And the present Chief Justice of India, he had earlier ruled on this. It's a bit of a legal minefield, but I think most civilized societies and most civilized democracies, defamation is not a criminal offense. That means you can't just put a person behind bars. And the other thing that we saw in the case of The Wire is ex parte injunctions. Again, the judiciary has the right. Judges have the right. But is it fair? Is it in keeping with the principles of natural justice that you pass an injunction, you pass an order against an individual without giving that person the right to be heard? Okay, Nidhi.
And you know, you've touched on a lot of points, actually, Paranjoy. from the criminal defamation issue to others that we need to get into in a bit more detail. And Maheshwar, just, you know, give us some ray of hope, because you've actually won some of these cases.
So, I was a publisher for Outlook for about 15 years, and we fought quite a few cases. And one of the things that we always used to say, and Vinod, God bless him, he was one of those people who said that never be bothered about a litigation. And one of the things that me and Vinod possibly appeared in about 100 court cases at different places in the country is it will never let the other person think he's harassing us. So when we go to the court and stand in front of the court, we'll be laughing at each other. We'll say, what after this? Do we go for lunch? What's for drink? And so on and so forth. So that the other party understands that for us, it's a normal course and it's not something that's harassing us. Having said that, Saharas, Ambanis, everyone that Paranjoy talked of had filed cases against us, and some of them are still moving on. But they typically go into a cold storage at some point in time. One of the cases that I did was against IIPM, Arindam Chaudhary. And I consider him the guru of fraud in every sense of the word. Because quite simply, what he was doing was he was playing with the vulnerability of the Indian parent and the Indian student and using that to amass money. And ultimately, what he gives is a fraud degree with a fake placement and with no life for the student, for the child. And at some point in time, they completely get destroyed. So when we did the story in 2009, I had my own company called Career 360, and I was not backed by Outlook those days. We went after him and said, IIPM is best only in claims. Because he was actually best only in claims and nothing more. He first started filing a case against me and my erstwhile promoters at Outlook, because that's one case of bullying. You know, you bring in people that not in your control, and you try to make them impose themselves on you to withdraw the case or at least apologize. And then he went, because the case came up in Delhi, and we went fighting for it, and we did have a modification of an injunction order. So there was an ex parte injunction that was given. Within 3 months, we got that overturned by the judge, because we told the judge that here is the evidence that we have. Do you want us not to publish this in public interest? The judge saw through the injunction and modified the order by saying that you can go ahead publishing as long as you give Arindam the right to respond to that, and that also is published in half a page, with another half a page reserved for you to respond to that response. So he actually did not quash the order, but as much as quash the order, because he saw through the game. And when we started publishing the stories, that's when the real hard response of a corporate bully happens. He filed about seven, across the country, in seven courts he filed cases. One of them was Uttarakhand, one of them in Kamrup in Assam, and so on and so forth. Criminal, civil, contempt of an injunction, and so on and so forth. He did everything possible. One of the only things that we did was we said, come what may, we're not going to give in. The challenge about defamation and about journalism is, if you're worried about the repercussions, don't do the story. But don't, for God's sake, do a story and apologize or compromise. The day you do that, what was a normal guy becomes a Frankenstein. Because what he goes and tells a student at that point in time is that, listen, these guys did a story and now they apologized. It strengthens his selling point. I'd much rather not do a story than do a story and apologize. That's something that I was committed to. And once we start getting into the details of the case, we realized that we need to come what may fight it. And every single time when we had any information, we pushed put it. We had an injunction against us from an Assam court. We had an opinion which said that the Assam court injunction appeal applies only to Assam. So we start carrying stories on a platform, web platform, by culling out Assam and ensuring that the Assam students don't get it. We did not stop carrying the stories against him despite the injunction. It was very important for me because I kept telling myself, if I don't inform the student, another 1,000 students will get sucked up into the mess. And that for me is a crime. The crime is not that I'm writing against him. The crime would be if I don't write against him. Thankfully, at one point in time, and the judicial system is such that in one case in Uttarakhand, me and Lakshmi, my wife, is sitting here, we had an arrest warrant against us. And it so happened that in 60 days, it seems summons were served thrice, which I rejected. And mind you, I was accepting summons for the other six courts. It's only the Uttarakhand summons which mysteriously came to me and I was not even taking them. And so three refusal of summons, 60 days, 14 days is typically the gap that you have for serving a summon, mind you. So look at the speed of the judicial process and the efficiency. I wish it was there every single time, right? And within 60 days, we had an arrest warrant against us. And then I get a call saying, listen, buddy, you don't want to be arrested. Why don't you just settle the whole thing? And then you have this great member of parliament called Chandan Mitra carrying a story about me saying, legal circles are eagerly watching how this man will deal with this because now the court has already issued a warrant against him. He never carried a story when we won the case. That is pioneer for you. But the challenging thing is, you know, I told my lawyer that I would never go to this trial court. For the simple reason the way it conducted itself till the arrest warrant. We went to the High Court. The first ray of hope that we got was a Uttarakhand High Court order. We said that the truth, the ultimate, you know, defense in defamation is truth, and there is nothing but truth that this man has said. And because he said the truth, everything else is abuse of judicial process. So every single order against me was squashed as far as Uttarakhand was concerned. Then we moved to Chandigarh. Then we moved to Delhi. There are four High Court cases that we won. Then I moved to the Supreme Court and said that, listen, guys, four cases I have won. There are 10 more cases lying all over the place. Can you please put all these cases together? Because I'm in Delhi, he's in Delhi, his institute is in Delhi, my company is in Delhi. But the cases are all over the place. Can you please sort this out? All these fraudsters, and I'm using the word fraudsters, he can file a case again after me. All these fraudsters are scared of approaching the Supreme Court because they know that their order would be beyond what you seek. Say in the case of Sahara. You know, SEBI said that it's illegal. Supreme Court said it's not just illegal, you must also repay them. Similarly, in IAPM's case, in my opinion, if we had gone and fought at Supreme Court level, the Supreme Court would have not just, you know, ratified what we said, but would have also possibly adjudicated that the students must be repaid the fee. It's a possibility. So this fraudster went to the Supreme Court, gave an undertaking that I'm withdrawing every single case, and he withdrew the case. For me, journalism would survive when journalists will start learning how to be aggressive in defense and not just defending themselves. Because as long as we keep defending ourselves and keep taking the blows on ourselves, these guys will be bullies and they'll keep bullying you. Thank you.
Josy.
I think there are two aspects to this entire business of litigations. One is a very basic defamation notices. That's a lawyer who sends a notice to you, and that's good enough to shut out most mainstream media houses in this country. And that's an embarrassingly sad situation. You know, I was in Times of India. There was an audit of the CAG, which was of Delhi Power Distribution, which was being kept secret through a Delhi High Court order. I got hold of it, probably tricked my editors into publishing it. And when it was published, and we were just started publishing, and in the next 24 hours, Anil Ambani Group sends a legal notice asking for a 5,000 crore defamation. 5,000 crore as compensation for defaming him. The immediate result was that Times of India just stopped publishing any more articles on that issue. So you don't need to take anyone to court. In this country, a legal notice is enough to shake up most media houses. And spying, as you know, is a very rare commodity here. Once a case goes to court, then whatever Mahesh said or Paranjoy said happens. I'm right now facing two civil defamation cases, each one for 1,000 crore compensation asked by Jet Airways. The case is in Mumbai High Court. My book was published in Delhi, and I am based in Delhi, and Jet Airways, I think, flies to Delhi and operates out of Delhi also. But he files in Mumbai because in most parts of India, if you want to file a civil defamation case, you have to deposit 1 to 10% of the total amount demanded as a court fee in the court. But in Mumbai High Court, strangely, you only need to deposit a maximum of 3 lakh rupees. So Jet Airways has deposited 3 lakh rupees and they've got Harish Salve and Janaki Das to vet their case and file the case against me. So I have, as Maheshwar pointed out, I filed a very aggressive return statement saying that I want to present not just documents to back up my book, I want to present more documents to show how Jet Airways promoter Naresh Goyal was mixed up with underworld and criminals and Dawood Ibrahim and Hawala dealers, etc. So his lawyers sought inspection of documents, which is allowed under civil defamation case. Last week, they fixed a date and I took a flight from Delhi, went there, checked into a hotel. Morning, 2 hours before our meeting was to happen, their lawyer informs us that, sorry, my client is busy. And this is how the harassment begins. The lawyers do not want, the Jet Airways do not want the case to go to the court because I'm going to be tabling documents which are extremely embarrassing, not only embarrassing for them, but also which will have global repercussions because of the documentation showing how he was mixed up with a global terrorist. But by my lawyer's assessment, it is going to take 10 to 15 years for the case to end. So that's a harassment. But as Maheshwar said, there is no point to turn around because the question is no more about me. And while I was preparing my return statement, I figured out that in 70 years of our independence, we have not even codified what are the privileges of a journalist or a writer. So you can go to any lower court in any corner of this country and harass him. Why can't the Supreme Court or the High Court ever, for God's sake, codify what is a privilege? If the Constitution gives freedom of expression, there is a need to be codified. So I think the fight begins from the very beginning because we are actually living through the Gilded Age of India. The robber barons are all having great fun. We have got enough number of lawyers out there who are willing to file any kind of case for the right money. And we can say that we will keep fighting and truth will prevail. I think it is not about truth prevailing. It is about India becoming from a banana republic to a real republic. And I think that fight is a hard one.
Well, just taking off on what the different speakers have raised, and firstly what Josy said, Paranjoy, about the media lacking a spine. There are still a few writers and obviously journalists like all of you, The Wire, that are still brave enough to stick their necks out and do stories that would make corporate giants uncomfortable, and you guys are doing that. But most media houses don't do that. And is that because there's a fundamental problem with the structure of the media in India today, that many of these media houses are now corporate houses, essentially? What is it that prevents them from speaking
up? You hit the nail on the head, Nidhi. Considering that she's from New Delhi Television, and we're all waiting to watch and waiting to find out who will become the new controller of New Delhi Television, or whether Dr. Pranoy Roy and Radhika Roy will continue in their position, even though there's a considerable amount of uncertainty. What Nidhi has said is absolutely correct. We have a situation today in India where some of the richest men in India are also controlling very, very large sections of the media. The biggest media barons are also individuals who have substantial industrial interests, and the fourth estate is real estate, the fourth estate is petrochemicals, the fourth estate is plastics, the fourth estate is polyester, the fourth estate is telecom. Nehru used to talk about the jute and steel press, and so did V.K. Krishnamenon. But that's all history now. I mean, the Jain family used to have a substantial holding in a company called New Central Jute Mills. The Tata Iron and Steel Company, TISCO as it was called, used to have some interest in a publication that was big in Eastern India called The Statesman. The late Ramnath Goenka, who founded the Indian Express Group, he at one time wanted to take control over the Indian Iron and Steel Company. But over the years, something's changed. And the notable examples are the Jagran Group and the Bhaskar Group. The Jagran, by the way, is one of the world's most widely circulated daily newspapers. It's the most widely read publication in India. Now, in their case, they started off in the media and then got into a whole lot of other areas. We have a number of other examples of families that started out as bringing out publications, being a part of the media, and today have interest in everything from coal mining to power plants, to fertilizer plants, to chemical plants, and of course, real estate. When Josy says the Times of India, I mean, the Times of India is no ordinary organization. Bennett Coleman Company Limited, the Times Group, happens to be Asia's biggest publisher. I mean, the Times of India Group, one out of two editions of an English newspaper sold in this country is an edition of the Times of India. The Times of India happens to be the world's most widely circulated daily English newspaper. So we are here talking about large corporate bodies. So when you have a conflict of interest, and it's not just pressure from the advertiser, it's the ownership itself, then what has happened is the space for dissenting voices, for critical voices, for the journalist to play the role of an antagonist, to play the role of an adversary, for the journalist not to be a stenographer, not to be an advertising agent, not to be a PRO, but to actually hold truth to power. That has become increasingly difficult. Those spaces for dissension have shrunk. The Chief Justice of India, Justice Deepak Mishra, before he became Chief Justice, he presided over a bench. It's a long judgment. You should read it. It's a lot of flowery prose. But the short point is, he sought to equate a person's right to reputation with a person's right to free expression. Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution of India defines freedom of expression as a fundamental right. We also have Article 19(2), which says that there can be reasonable restrictions on the right to free speech. So you can't say something which results in two communities beating each other up, people killing each other. You can't have a situation where, you know, the right to free speech or people saying hate speech, which results in defamation. The problem is this word reasonable. Reasonable restrictions. You can say, okay, the Chief Justice of India will decide what is a reasonable restriction. But no, unfortunately, it's your local cop. It's your local mafia don. They are the one who decide who is being reasonable or not. This is the city of Gauri Lankesh. Remember, she was gunned down in cold blood in front of her home. What was her crime? That she spoke her mind out. So this is the atmosphere, and I disagree with Nidhi, and I hope Josy had worn a black shirt. Yes, this does reflect the current environment we are in at present in India.
I just want to say that what you said on journalism, I mean, reporting on big corporates in India and journalists not becoming PR agents for what they're reporting on, it's actually true of all journalists today. I mean, look at political journalists. What are they doing? They're essentially taking handouts from the government, from the ruling party, and regurgitating that as news. It's true across the board. There's no fact-checking. There's no counter-questioning. I mean, look at the way, for instance, the ferry in Gujarat was reported last week. The first ever ferry in South Asia is what the Prime Minister said. No, not really. Yeah, the Ro-Ro ferry. But, you know, it's there in Kerala. I think there are four of them in South Asia. So the media stopped doing, most of the media stopped doing this basic fact-checking. But Maheshwar, I just want to ask you that what is it about Indian business houses when it comes to the way they function? It's so opaque. They don't like anything critical written about them, isn't it? And I haven't personally reported on corporate affairs at all. I've only reported on politics for 20 years. But just give us an insight into that. They're so touchy, aren't they, even about the slightest bit of criticism that's written about them.
You know, there's an interesting thing that I'll tell you about. When I was fighting the IIPM case, this lawyer was fighting, you know, I had one lawyer who was a brilliant lawyer. He was fighting for me all over the place. And one day I went and gave him the balance sheet of IIPM and said, listen, his turnover is 600 crores. And from 9,000 students, he's fallen down to 300 students. Because the attack by me against him was, you know, continuous over 3 years. So at that point in time, he said, Mahesh, aapne unke pet pe laat mara hai, be careful. Business houses which suffer monetary losses will hit back. That's a fact. If we don't understand that, we should not report on business. Quite simple. Every business house which is losing money because of your story is going to come back and hit back at us. And to that extent, we should be a bit more rigorous in our investigation, a bit more rigorous in the kind of evidence that we gather against them, so that, you know, it can't be a story which you finish, polish off in 1 week and try to publish it. That's not going to work when it comes to business houses because they have lawyers backing them. I'll also take on Paranjoy's one small thing. See, because I've been a publisher, so unlike, I was not a journalist. I'm sorry, I'm not a journalist. I don't want to be a journalist. Because, see, I've run the magazine as a publisher. There are risks that publishers take. There are risks that business, you know, the owners take. My heart goes out to Dr. Pranoy Rai for what he's going through at this point in time. He's fought every single day for the last 25 years and has come to the state. And that's because we as people are only empathizing with him but can't do much beyond that. And on the other side, you have an establishment. And when the establishment wants to hit back at you, they'll hit back at you come what may. I've gone through it in 2001 where my wife would get a call from some guy. He says, aapka husband aaj ghar pe nahi aayega, CBI le ja rahi hai use. And she would be shuddering, thinking whether I'll come or not. You know, that's a challenge that she has. When the establishment wants to go after you, they'll go after you and they'll find the flimsiest reason to go after you. And they'll incapacitate you, they'll paralyze you. That's what the state that we are currently in. And it's not just under BJP. It happened in the previous regime and it will continue to happen in the next few regimes also, as long as the laws don't change. The laws are against people talking of for truth, which may hurt people or the facade or the reputation that they built very meticulously over a period of time. When you try to destroy that, they come back and hit back at you very, very strongly.
Do you want to weigh in on more on what I had asked Paranjoy about the media? You have worked in the Times of India, where I'm sure you have much more to say on just how corporate interests often and market interests and forces would override good journalism.
Yeah, I mean, Nidhi, one thing is about individuals, whether it's Dr. Roy or the Jain family. I think ethics and values are very lonely personal pursuits. So I don't buy into this claim, you know, arguments about they're being harassed and all that. I think it's your personality, your character, your dignity that comes up when you are in bad times. So I don't have any great sympathy for Dr. Roy or others. But we have created, and thanks largely to Times of India, that you can buy a newspaper cheaper than a glass of Pepsi in this country. And probably it's the only country where you can do that. So when you are willing to buy such cheap trash, you will get third-rate journalism. Nidhi, I don't want to get into the negatives of it. So Times of India Group is not just the Asia's largest, world's largest English newspaper. They're also probably India's largest private equity investor, holding stakes in something like 15,000 companies. So I don't know to what extent is it a newspaper and to what extent is it a, according to Vineet Jain, Times of India is an advertisement agency. That's the owner's words. But I think what I see, Nidhi, is that while journalists like us, so, you know, I have a permanent folder in my email where I keep storing away all my dead stories in the hope that, you know, I will use it in some books or somewhere, wherever, or pass it around. And it's a large number of them regularly.
Make sure you have a hard copy backup.
I'm encrypting all of them now. No, actually, there is somebody who's doing a research on my dead stories.
I'm serious also, because yeah. These are very different times.
Yeah. So, but Nidhi, what I want to take this thing to is, because of this kind of very devious, flimsy, immoral media atmosphere, there is a lot of pushback. There is a lot of us who are talking and thinking of finding solutions. And I know friends in NDTV who are talking about it. I know Paranjoy is now starting off on a large project. I'm hoping to get into my next books about it, because I realize that books are a way to stand up for yourself. Because when Jet Airways has filed the case against me, there are two cases. One is where I and my publisher are involved. Other is where I and his former magazine Outlook is involved. And Outlook's written statement, which they have not shared with me, is embarrassing for a media house. The editor, without consulting me, has agreed to publish a rejoinder if Jet gives. So I'm just saying that it is not about the structural problems. What I am seeing is that in a time like this, when all across politics, business, there is such deep immorality, there is a new generation of journalists who are rising up, not in large numbers, but standing up firmly, who are looking at new options, and internet is opening up ways. So I think we are entering the golden era of journalism. And don't forget the fact that when US went through its dark ages of Gilded Age in the 20s and 30s, they saw some of the finest muckraking journalism. So I think we are entering that.
I think that's a terrific analysis, because we often tend to look at things through gloom and doom. Yeah, quickly, and then I'd like to open it up to the audience for
I just wanted to have two quick reactions, one to what Josy has said, one to what
Maheshwar Peri has said. You know, Josy is right. Today, duniya mutthi mein hai. Jiha, I didn't say it, Mr. Ambani said it. But today we carry in the palm of our hand our newspaper, our library of books, our magazine, our radio, our television, and more. Because the internet is not just a medium of mass communication, it's also a medium of personalized communication. But if everybody wants everything free, everything you read, everything you listen to, everything you watch, think a bit. Who pays for the school fees of Josie's children? Who pays for Maheshwar Peri's black kurta? Oh, no, not black kurta. I mean, look. Who pays for the singer? Who pays for the artist? Who? I mean, this whole notion of copyright, the whole notion of intellectual property rights, they're undergoing significant changes. And we are seeing new revenue models emerging, because what has happened is, after the Great Recession of 2008, the slowdown, the decline, or the deceleration of advertising incomes, or advertising expenditure, I beg your pardon, has had an impact on mainstream media organizations. But what we also see on the other side, new models emerging. And we see, for instance, the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists, the Panama Papers. And wait and watch, there's more coming there. Because they are now, the issue is of funding by foundations. My friend Ram is here. He's a part of the Independent and Public-Spirited Media Foundation. We have other organizations, crowdfunding. Look at crowdfunding. I'm not exactly letting you in on a secret, but within days of the Amit Shah story appearing in The Wire, Wire actually saw a surge in the donations they got. I myself was surprised when, in this city, I worked on a documentary film on the illegal iron ore mining in Bellary and Anantapur. I didn't realize so many hundreds of people, some would give me small amounts, some would give me large amounts to fund it. So these new models are emerging, which gives me some reason for optimism, what Josy talked about. And one more point, what Maheshwar Peri said. Yeah, if you're going to hurt them financially, they'll hit back, of course. I personally know that the esteemed trustees of the Samiksha Trust, which owns and publishes the Economic and Political Weekly, I was directed, stroke ordered, I was stroke instructed to bring down an article which is still on The Wire, and the facts of that case still haven't been challenged. They haven't been refuted. But yes, I said, here is an application made for refund of duties to the extent of more than 500 crore, which has been denied to the Adani Group, a company in the Adani Group. So you're right, what Maheshwar Peri says, absolutely right. You better get your facts right. Otherwise, you yourself will have to suffer. Across the world and also in India, there are dozens of cases of people who are rich, who are powerful, who are influential, who misuse the law. So you have to be prepared for that.
I'd like to open this up to the audience, and the first question to Ram Guha, only because I liked his speech this morning.
Thank you for your indulgence. You've heard enough bullshit from me already. But I have a couple of things to say, seeing this panel. One, very quickly. The first is a personal story. 35 years ago, I was a doctoral student in Kolkata. And I had lunch in Chungwa restaurant in Titaranjan Avenue with Paranjoy, Guha, Thakurta, and another person I will not name. Paranjoy was then with a business weekly. I'm not sure which one, maybe Business World or one of them. With a business weekly, which is technically more beholden to corporate ads. The other person was an editor with the Statesman, which is run by a trust that's theoretically independent. Paranjoy wanted to do a story on environmental degradation by a chemical firm. And the person in a newspaper run by a trust said, we're all college classmates, said, are you sure ads will be withdrawn? Your proprietor will get angry. Two models of journalism, as Josy said, inside you, Paranjoy and the unnamed person. Paranjoy is here. The unnamed person has served two terms as a BJP MP.
And no prizes for guessing his name.
Okay. And And yet, all of them have survived. If you're honest, you have integrity, that person has no credibility. He will never be called to any literary festival. He may be nominated to the Rajya Sabha, it doesn't matter. Okay, so that's the first positive side. If you're like Josy and Nidhi and Paranjoy, Nidhi, by the way, I should say one thing about, if I may make one more anecdotal point. I'm trolled a lot on Twitter, but any woman with my views is trolled 10 times as much. And that Nidhi is included in that. So these people will continue with their courage to do the work. Though it's an arduous job, it's more difficult than it was when Paranjoy and I were young. It's harder for the Josy and Nidhi in some ways than when we were young. That's the first point. The second point is a more important point. And I'd like you to, some of you to talk about it. You know, it's possible to have Paranjoy and Nidhi and Josy here. It's much more difficult to have equally brave, courageous, independent-minded Kannada, Bengali, Malayalam, Hindi writers. That's why Gauri Lankesh was killed. And I'd like a little bit of reflection on that.
No, I just need to also mention the fact that some of the finest non-fiction writing in this country is happening because of the trust that Ram Guha runs. And it's a very courageous thing. And Bangalore is a city where India's hope lies for various reasons. So I hope many of you will leave this session with positive responses. I don't want your money, but I hope you will do things which will help encourage good journalism. You know, in the Voltaire way, you don't need to agree with us, but you need to fight for and stand up for our right to say what you don't agree with. I agree completely with Mr. Guha said about vernacular. We have a very serious, dangerous situation where in the vernacular, the advertiser is now the mafia. The newspaper owners are mere slaves of them. The biggest ones. The smaller ones are bending over backwards to please a politician and the advertiser. But, you know, look at my home state, Kerala and other places. Advertisers have taken over the place. Any illegality by the advertiser or the big politician is not even reported. And there are no threats to me. I mean, I personally don't get physically threatened by anybody. But you look at the condition of our reporters in Mufissal towns, they get killed. And they're killed in large numbers. We are almost as bad as Somalia if you look at, as a proportion of population, if you look at the number of journalists getting killed, we would be at the rate of maybe Somalia or something. But because we are a large country and we have got so many population proportions, the numbers don't really add up. But mind you, we are in a really bad situation as far as vernacular media is concerned.
One brief intervention. Ram, thank you for all your flattering remarks. All I'm saying is about Gauri. Since I worked with her and I worked with her on this Bellari film, Gauri's English was as good as Ram Guha's or mine. She could have been in the Times of India or NDTV or any such organization. The very fact that she was not just one of the few female editors in this country, but that because she communicated with people in the Kannada language and could reach out to people in small towns and small villages, at one level, made her more influential, but it also made her extremely vulnerable. And I completely endorse what Ram is saying. There are 1,000 Gauri Lankeshes in this country, but they, if when they see that a person like this in the heart of Bangalore, a person who in more ways than one was like us, people like us, born into privilege. We don't have to worry about where our next meal is going to come from or whether there's a roof over our head. They are far more vulnerable. As Josy said, at least 50 journalists have died under mysterious, unusual circumstances in the last decade. Over 100 activists using a law of the land, the right to information law, have died under mysterious circumstances in this country in the recent past. The sad part of the story that the perpetrators of that crime, no action, little or no action has been taken against them.
Let me just get another question in before I start talking again. Yeah, go ahead. Just wait for the mic, yeah.
Question is in relation to the spine that we talked about, right? How can journalists hold on? So most of you have been backed by big organizations. I belong to a very niche media organization called yourstory.com. I was slapped with a defamation case of 1 crore and by an investor who I'm not going to name here. We did the story first, though everybody knew about it, and despite our getting his side of the story. Now, my question is that for a journalist like me, how long can we continue the case? Because sometime a time will come when the organizations will say, okay, let's cave in, and then let's say, let's apologize. What do journalists like me then do?
I think, first of all, it's wrong to, for you to say that all of us are backed by big organizations. I run my own company, and all the cases that I fought in the last 7 years are on my own company. The only way you fight such bullying tactics is to have so much reach, so much scale, that they might hate you but still have to be with you. That's the only way you deal with this problem. When I started Career 60, I said IBM filed a case. Ruyas of Usha, they filed a case in somewhere in Ahmedabad. And Sohail said wanted to file a case against me and so on and so forth, because he took a doctorate from the Ruyas for whatever, you know. No, I don't know why they take doctorates from those fraud institutions. Kiran Bedi took one, by the way. And he had a picture. Those Ruyas were selling a degree saying Kiran Bedi is with our event. Anyways. So when this happened, what I did was, I said that, and there were a lot of advertisers who were demanding a lot of things from us the way advertisers demand. And I realized that I can't give it to them, because I'd rather close it than have a child come and tell me that because of you, I took a decision because of which I've taken a wrong decision and my life is screwed. I don't want that pop. I'd rather go and sell rice. It's easy for me. So what I did was I created a scale where at this point in time on Career 360, which is a small organization which is funded by my own money, for the first 7 years, I did not even take a single penny of venture capital funding, because I realized that if I take their money, they'll tell me what to do and what not to do. They'll not let me do a story against IIPM. They'll not let me do a story against Vegan and Lay and whatever you call it. My single reason was I have to create an impact where every child takes a more informed decision. So we start creating skills. Today we have 20 million students on the platform every month. Half my advertisers hate us. They hate us, but they cannot avoid us. The way you deal with these bullies is to create such scale that they can't avoid you and they start falling at your feet, which is what you must do.
I just wanted to add to what you said. Look, ma'am, my case is being fought by myself. I'm spending my money, and I spent a lot of money already, okay? But I think I don't measure my journalism or my impact by the money I lose or spend. And I don't think I'm paying some price. I look at it from the perspective of the impact I make. I had at least 2-3 people who walked up to me and said, we don't anymore fly Jet Airways. I mean, I don't think we should be so bothered about the financial equations. But there are also a lot of good lawyers out there. Like, you know, my case, Prashant Bhushan signed down, vetted my filing without taking a penny from me. So I think you'll find good people out there. It's not that everything is dark and gloom.
A brief reaction, madam. I completely empathize with you. The very purpose of a slap suit is to try and bankrupt you, is to try and prolong it for as long as possible. My colleague and close friend is not here, Subir Ghosh. He and I, we've co-authored a book called Sue the Messenger, How Legal Harassment by Corporates Shackles Reportage and Undermines Democracy. But I empathize completely with you. But what Josy has said, what Maheshwar has also said, you will find supporters and sympathizers. They want you to give up. They want you to give in. They want you to cave in and capitulate. So you have spine, isn't it?
And one, just to add,
and may your spine become stronger.
Just to talk of spine, you know, because you're talking of spine, the case that I fought against IIPM had 300 hearings across 14 courts across the country. And one lawyer was running all over because I didn't want to trust any other lawyer. And this lawyer would otherwise charge 2.5 lakhs per hearing. He'll charge me 25,000.
There seems to be one solution emerging in India. Two stories in Deccan Herald today. One KS officer here, he says, I am being provoked to commit suicide. Story you can read later. Second story is 50,000 young people in India in the age of 19 to 25 are committing suicide every year. Every year, 50,000 young people of India. So what is the future of India? We can think. Now, I have a question. I believe in nonviolence totally. Yet, I wrote a book, a murder story. The inspiration came to me from JNU and Mr. Arun Jaitley. It so happened, in JNU we had a big meeting. Arun Jaitley, me and Rajesh Pilot were the speakers. After the meeting, I met 40 students of the JNU in 1 week, in their hostel, in their cafeteria, etc. Whatever they said to me, I took a note, came back to Bangalore, then I wrote a book. It is a murder story, though I don't believe in murder. But who was murdered? That is very important. 1997, it was Manmohan Singh was murdered. Because JNU students told me the stories that I wrote, and so far I'm still waiting for maybe jail sentence or something. Nothing has happened. What is happening in this country? Let's think.
So that's a very large philosophical question, which will require an entire day of deliberations. No, yeah, none of us are planning to do any such thing. But I before we close, I just want to ask Josy, what is the difference, you think, between this establishment today and the previous establishments? Yes, you know, Maheshwar is right. The previous government has also harassed the media when it hasn't agreed with stories that have been done. But what is different about this establishment?
So, you know, during the UPA 2 time, some of the big scandals had my byline or stories, and I think our coverage did impact the creation of India Against Corruption, etc. And I've had 2 close tapes with Official Secrets Act 2 during that time. But I think the difference is very clear of all the 5-6 governments that I've covered and prime ministers that I've covered. Until now, it was all retail bullying. Now we have a wholesale bullying with, and there is no dignity here. It's a crass, almost criminal enterprise out there. Do anything and silence you. And I think that is frightening, and you should be frightened, because after 2 years, 3 years, or maybe 5 years, they will go away and we might all disperse. But if you are citizens of a democratic country, you should be worried, because the damage to institutions, including exploiting the vulnerabilities of mainstream media, that this government is doing is unparalleled. And I have not seen in the last 25 years. Have you, Paranjoy?
I completely agree with you, Josy. But before I respond to you, I want to be a little philosophical like the gentleman over here. You know, none of us like to be criticized. When our mother and fathers told us that you shouldn't do this, we didn't like it. But somewhere along the line, as we mature, we realize that somebody is criticizing you in a constructive manner. And others are criticizing you because they just don't like your face. They want to destroy you. They want to squash your ego. But wait, sir. Whoever's in power will always want the media to be subservient. That's human nature. And you know, if a journalist has to hold truth to power and is not to act as a stenographer and hold accountable those who are in positions in power or authority and ensure there's greater transparency in public life, then we have to try and see how all of you members of our society can strengthen civil society. And my simple, humble submission to all of you is that, as Josy says, are you willing to support independent journalism? Do you believe independent journalism is going to strengthen democracy? If yes, then don't keep quiet, because your silence will be interpreted as complicity. I completely agree with Josy. I've been in the profession for 40 years. And when I started my career, it was the emergency. Indira Gandhi. I'm going to be speaking in the next few minutes. I'll have to be running away from here, but I'm here today and tomorrow. I'm happy to engage with all of you. I'll have to be engaging with Sagarika Ghosh on a book on Indira Gandhi. Never since the emergency, never since the dark days of the emergency, are we seeing concerted attempts by those who are in positions of power and authority stifling the voices of dissent in this country. And Gauri Lankesh's death was one manifestation of an attempt to shut our voices. Do not be cowed down. Speak out. Speak up. What's it called? Speak up? Speak up. Speak up. Speak up. The darkest hour is just before the dawn.
All right. Well, I'm afraid we have to end it there today. This has been a fascinating conversation. Thank you to the audience. Thank you to our panelists. Thank you very much.